And joining us for Hot Copy to give us the latest on Taal's activity and what can we expect in the coming days, we have with us Dr. Renato Solidum. He's the director of the Philippine Institute of Volcanology and Seismology, or PHIVOLS. Welcome to Hot Copy, Dr. Solidum. Thank you for doing this interview.
Good morning, Karen.
What can we expect in the next couple of days, Dr. Solidum, given that Taal volcano is not showing signs of slowing down just yet?
Well, Taal volcano is currently still erupting, although generally weaker than the previous days. However, we still record a lot of earthquakes in the Taal volcano region, and many of these earthquakes have been felt. Associated with the occurrence of earthquakes are the fissuring and ground deformation observed on the southwestern to western side to northern side of the volcano. This can be interpreted as magma intruding from beneath the volcano, causing fissures to move, causing the earthquakes, and also lifting up the ground. Hence, if this magma would continue to rise, there can still be further activity related to the current situation.
All right. Now, in layman's terms, for residents and ordinary people to understand, are you saying, Dr. Solidum, that this will take a few more days, a few more weeks, or historically speaking, which Taal has experienced, it can last to a few more months?
Well, Taal volcano has exhibited various styles of eruption in the past. In 1911, the eruption lasted for around 3 to 4 days only. In 1965, the eruption lasted for 1 month. And in 1754, the eruption lasted for around 7 months. This would be dependent on the ascent of the magma, how fast it would move up, or whether the magma would stop moving. And as we try to analyze this, we rely on two things, the earthquakes and the deformation on the ground.
Are you able to measure, Dr. Solidum, do we have instruments for this, or it's just analysis? How much magma is still inside the volcano? How much is stored? How much is on the crater? I'm just curious if you're able to scientifically measure it.
Well, prior to the eruption of the volcano, there was a small volume of magma beneath the volcano that was already shallow, 5 kilometers to 3 kilometers. But the recent activity of the volcano, we need to further analyze how much magma is intruding in relation to the current earthquakes and ground deformation.
Okay. You've said there's a possibility of a hazardous eruption. How would you define hazardous eruption compared to the first eruption, which was phreatic? It had no magma, but yet it caused a lot of damage in terms of the ash fall. What would be the difference when you say hazardous eruption?
Let me clarify the activities exhibited by Taal volcano on Sunday. It started initially as a phreatic eruption, meaning the cause of the eruption was the steam that had a lot of pressure, and the steam was essentially produced when the hot magma boiled the water at the main crater. And that phreatic eruption can be confirmed by the fact that the ashes thrown out by the volcano are old, based on our analysis. However, after the phreatic eruption, the crater was depressurized. It's just like cooking rice. Mm-mm. Once the water in the pot is boiling, then the steam would want to get out, and it would sometimes lift the cap of the pot or the cover of the pot. When you take off the cover, the steam would suddenly rise and get out of the pot. So when the phreatic eruption occurred in Taal volcano main crater, it depressurized the condition of the system, and the magma suddenly rose. And by 2 o'clock, we saw that the magma is rapidly rising. And the interaction of the magma produced more eruptions, and it became a phreatomagmatic eruption, meaning magma is already involved by late in the afternoon. Mm-hmm. And we have evidence that there was new magma from the ash that reached Manila. By early morning of Monday, we saw already lava fountaining essentially coming out. So that's a pure magmatic eruption. So the highest eruption column we saw was around 10 to 15 kilometers last Sunday, late afternoon and evening. And for many volcanoes, that would be considered really hazardous. It was indeed a hazardous eruption, but we have not seen pyroclastic density currents, the flow of rocks and ashes moving down the slope of the volcano, or even horizontally moving out of the eruption crater towards the lake. That is what we call a hazardous volcanic eruption, when Taal would exhibit the production of not only tall eruption columns, but horizontally moving clouds of more than 60 kilometers per hour that could even reach the mainland and cross above the water. That has happened in 1965 in a minor scale. That has happened in 1911 in a bigger scale. And that has happened in 1754, while all the areas around the lake was devastated. And the earlier report by Jeff Canoy on the old church, formerly in the town of Taal, which is now San Nicolas, was buried by the pyroclastic density current or base surge in 1754. That is the hazardous explosive eruption in the case of Taal volcano, but it will be different for other volcanoes.
All right. Now, Director Solidum, with the characteristics that Taal volcano is showing today, no, we're talking about today, is it still possible that it will release what you've said, described as a hazardous explosion, like rocks coming out of the crater, pyroclastic material, or God forbid, just like Mount Pinatubo, even Lahar? Is that possible at this point?
Well, the explosive eruption that we are using as a scenario, and this is the scenario that we have been preparing for together with the Batangas Provincial Disaster Risk Reduction and Management Office, is still possible simply because of the fact that we still have a lot of earthquakes and ground deformation within the area. And this is interpreted by considering that perhaps the magma is intruding, causing movement of the fissures and also deforming the ground.
So you are saying it is still possible to have pyroclastic material, rocks. Are you saying even Lahar is possible, Director? I just wanted you to clarify this. It's
well,
still
Lahar
possible
is,
even...
Lahar is a non-volcanic hazard. So we have to take it out in the discussion of the actual eruption. However, if you talk about the possibility of Lahar, yes. However, this is somewhat different from Pinatubo. Taal volcano is a very small island. So even if there will be a Lahar in the area, nobody would be affected. But we have to take a look at the surrounding areas inside the caldera wall or the bigger volcano. If thick deposits would lie on the steep slopes, and that is happening now, and if this eruption would continue and cover more ashes on the steep slopes, when heavy rains would occur, this would be washed down the slope and produce shorter Lahar events.
Okay. Now, Taal volcano's characteristic, it has 47 craters. I'm curious if that has anything to do with the length in terms of the eruption, because Taal's had a history of, you just said, days, even months of erupting. Does the 47 craters have anything to do with this, Director Solidum?
There's no relation at all. Whether the explosion will occur in the main crater or not, the length of the eruption will be dependent on how much volume of magma will be erupted and how fast the magma is being moved out of the crater and how fast the magma is moving from below. So it is the ascent rate that will matter and the volume. So the craters will not really be important. However, it was important for us to know, if the volcano would start erupting, where would it start to erupt? And based on our analysis, even months before, we knew that most of the activities will be concentrated inside the main crater lake of Taal.
Yeah. A lawmaker wants to investigate essentially the process of how residents were warned regarding Taal's eruption. I want to give you an opportunity to clarify this. Many have asked if FEVOX had warned too late. Couldn't have residents been warned much earlier? They said that just... Yeah, go ahead, Director. Go ahead.
Okay. Well, if you look at different volcanoes, they have different styles of eruption. They have different speeds of eruption, and they have different precursors. In Taal Volcano, when we raised the alert to one, we already notified the local government and then the residents that indeed Taal Volcano is acting up. Second, many of the earthquakes in the last quarter of the year have been felt, and people actually would know that the volcano alert was raised to one. Now, when the volcano, any volcano, would erupt, it has to show signs. We have to detect signs that the activity is escalating. However, that volcano did not accelerate its activity. And in fact, even half a day or a day before, there were no significant earthquake events. And even maybe 12 or to 6 hours before, if you look at the seismic record, there was no indication. However, we noticed the increase in earthquake at around 11 o'clock. And we noticed that by 1 o'clock, there was increase in steaming. And because of that, we have ordered our staff to call all the officials that they can in the volcano island. We have to separate the volcano island from the mainland because those are the primary residents that need to evacuate immediately. Evacuation is always progressive. You don't evacuate right away. What is important is that they were called and they were told to evacuate the area immediately. Once the volcano showed another change in episode at 2 o'clock, when instead of discrete earthquake events, we have recorded tremors, continuous vibration from below, that indicated to us that magma is already moving to the crater. And this was followed by a larger explosion. Then we raised the alert level to 3. We called the Batangas Provincial Disaster Official and Office of Civil Defense to inform them about the raising before we can actually hand them out the bulletin.
But did you raise it first to alert level 2? Alert level 2, Director?
We continued to observe the activity of the volcano. And when we noticed that aside from the tall eruption columns, we began to record larger earthquake events, many were felt, then we interpreted this that magma is still moving up and larger volume of magma is moving up, hence we need to raise the alert level to 4. If you look at all of this, it happened in a span of 6 hours or so. The volcano will accelerate, then we have to accelerate our warning. These are the events that happened. If you compare this to Pinatubo, when it started initially with earthquake events in March, phreatic eruption in April, more steaming in May, and small ash emissions in June prior to the climactic eruption of June 15, you can see clearly the big difference in the timing and sequence of the events versus what happened last Sunday.
Okay, Director Solidum, given that Taal, the big change happened within a span of 6 hours, you've explained how FEVOX raised alert levels during specific changes with Taal's behavior. When should have the local government evacuated those living in Volcano Island or nearby towns? Which alert level do you think should people have been evacuated? Can you hear me, Director Solidum? All right, we're gonna take a quick break just now. Head Start, we'll be right back. Stay with us. Sir, Director Solidum, can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you now.
Okay, better. Okay. Sige, sir. Dr. Renato Solidum, he's the director of FEVOX. He's with us now live from FEVOX. Dr. Solidum, can you hear me right now? I just want to make sure.
Yes, I can hear you now.
All right, that's great. You've explained that it took a span of 6 hours for Taal's behavior to change dramatically. And
yes,
you've raised the alert levels each time the behavior of the volcano changed.
Yes.
At what point should the LGU have asked the residents to evacuate? Which alert level?
Well, in general, the alert level that requires the residents in the main, in the Taal Volcano Island to evacuate would be 3. However, we recommended that the residents be evacuated at alert level 2. And as I mentioned before the actual bulletin was officially released, our staffs at the Taal Volcano Observatory have called the officials of villages in the volcano island to evacuate because we see possibility of rapidly increasing activity.
Mm-mm.
Then
now,
the mainland would be evacuated when we raise it to 4.
Mm-mm. Dr. Solidum, would you describe Taal's behavior, its eruption, as unique, abnormal, rapid, fast? Because usually, if you raise alert levels, you'd think that residents or LGUs have enough time to actually act, right? And have animals out, for example, close shops. But this was a span of 6 hours in full, all of this. Is this the typical behavior of a volcano, or would you say Taal surprised us all?
Well, in some cases, Taal volcano would rapidly erupt in a span of like several days. And sometimes there will be some precursors and the volcano will not erupt at all. So the behavior of Taal, unlike many other volcanoes, can actually vary from having precursors and not erupting, from having precursors to erupting within several days and erupting after some preliminary eruptions to the climactic days within several weeks. However, please note that Taal Volcano Island has been recommended and it is a permanent danger zone. So ideally, people should not be there because of the fact that the volcano itself is an island.
Mm-mm.
And it has water around it. And the speed of evacuating will be quite difficult. It is unlike Mayon Volcano, where you just run down the slope and get away from the 6 kilometer permanent danger zone, and it will be enough. However, if the volcano would rapidly increase in its activity, then there will be additional evacuation. And that has happened. Unfortunately, the volcano changed its condition very rapidly.
I know
for the mainland, they had enough time.
Yeah. Okay. I know that FEVOX, many years back, has already recommended that Volcano Island or the town right near the crater should be deemed unlivable. Would you recommend after this eruption that all residents, all homes be removed from the island?
Well, the president has already approved the recommendation that there will be no permanent settlement in the area. And please note, Karen, before I forget, that all people were safe. 6,000 residents were evacuated safely. So we should not forget the fact that there was a system and there have been preparations for it. It's not like we warned and then they just evacuate. There have been a lot of preparation starting many years ago through, with different governors and with this recent administration of Governor Mandanas.
Okay. Dr. Solidum, we're going to show the latest graph. This is your latest graph on Taal. And can you explain exactly what this graph means?
Oh, the map that behind me?
Yes, yes.
Okay, this map is the worst case scenario map, which is typical of the 1754 eruption. We have considered various eruption centers on the volcano island. And based on the mapping that we have conducted for the 1754 deposit, we came out with the hazard map for basards or the pyroclastic density currents, which involved the horizontally moving, very high speed cloud of ashes, rocks, and gases. And the orange areas there are the areas that can be affected by the basards. And the yellow areas there would be areas we consider buffer zone of around 1 kilometer, because when the flow would stop its movement, there will be clouds, we call it eutrophication or ashes, that would still be moving up and may affect people. The orange areas would be roughly 10 to 14 kilometers away from the main crater of the volcano, except for some areas towards Balayan Bay that would be around 18 kilometers away. So essentially, this is the map used by the disaster management organizations involved, including the local government, to warn the people of the possibility of areas that can be affected by these basards or pyroclastic density current, and for them to be evacuated. If you look back at our bulletin raising the alert level to number 4, we have mentioned that high-risk areas within the 14-kilometer radius from the crater should be evacuated, and these are the areas shown in the map.